A long time ago, a great disturbance was felt in the Force as millions of voices cried out in terror and were suddenly silenced. But come on, could the Death Star really blow up a planet? It's Star Wars Day, you guys! Hey, Jedis and Siths, Trace Windu here for DNews. Get it? Like Mace? Okay. A key plot point in the original Star Wars story was the destruction of the planet Alderaan by the Death Star as a show of force to the rebel scum. Then, after the destruction, an asteroid field formed around Alderaan's star. But come on, would all this really happen? Yes, the movie is science fiction, but when have we nerds ever let that stop us from sciencing the shit out of something? Okay, first we need to know how much energy it takes to blow up a planet. Then we can work out if the Death Star could blow up something so much bigger than itself. Alderaan is like an M-class planet, right? It's Earth-like and similarly sized. Three nerdy researchers at the University of Leicester calculated how much power the Empire would have to impart into the planet to get it to overcome its own gravity and fly in all directions. It's a really big number. 2 octillion joules. The world energy consumption is only 56 billion joules. So these numbers are kind of difficult to fathom. Let's put it in perspectives we can comprehend, sort of. The power of our whole sun is 380 septillion joules. Astronomers call this one solar luminosity. Small numbers. So we can convert everything to that. So the energy required to blow up a planet, according to these researchers, would be about 5.2 solar luminosities, or the amount of energy our sun releases in a week. That's pretty insane. Phil Plate, bad astronomer and internet winner extraordinaire, says depending on the planet's size, though, it could be more difficult, like 582,000 solar luminosities. That would take 57 quadrillion megaton nuclear bombs to blow up. I mean, that's crazy. I love me some Plate, but for the sake of simplicity, let's go with the students, because we want the answer to be, you know, within reach. To generate all that energy, we would need to understand how the Death Star is powered. According to authors in the extended universe, I know, its hypermatter reactor is as powerful as several main sequence stars. As we're basing these numbers on our own sun's power of one solar luminosity, the Death Star may throw power around equivalent to, say, 7 of our sun, or 7 solar luminosities. That's way more than the 5.2 needed to blow up a planet. Note, by the way, our sun is actually a relatively small main sequence star, so this is a pretty conservative estimate. But it could be even easier than all of that. Shooting a big laser at a planet, that would just heat it up, and you'd have to get through all the mass to reach the core, vaporize it so it explodes. Very unlikely. Popular Mechanics got a bunch of sci-fi authors together and brainstormed the problem. My favorite hypothesis to come out of it is that the super laser fired by the Death Star is positronic. A positron is a positively charged antimatter twin of an electron. If they fired a pure antimatter positron beam at Alderaan, the massive matter-antimatter explosions would result. When matter and antimatter meet, they annihilate each other in a large release of energy. Because these matter-antimatter reactions are so powerful, according to author Ethan Siegel, you would only need the equivalent amount of antimatter of about 0.00000002% of the mass of the planet being destroyed. Even Phil Plate agrees that that might do it. But then what happens? In 1977, George Lucas described Alderaan as a planet in a system. It's not exactly canon, but other planets definitely exist there. When the Death Star's superlaser destroys Alderaan, what happens to those other planets? Actually, not that much. Asteroids accelerated by the release of heat and pressure from inside the planet would shoot outward toward the reaches of the solar system, but overall, the Alderaan system would be about the same. The mass of the planet would distribute around a new asteroid belt, and the system would just move on. Think of it like Mars's moon Phobos. It's set to be torn asunder in the next 30 to 50 million years, but it won't disrupt Mars's orbit. The mass is going to be pretty much the same. A quick wobble and back to business as usual. Look, this is obviously science fiction. It's a fanciful story, but the best part about science is it can make these stories feel more real. Arthur C. Clarke's third law of scientific prediction is any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. If the Empire can wield many times the power of our whole sun in a single spacecraft, it would be like magic to us. But of course, no matter how powerful the Death Star was, it is insignificant next to the power of the Force. I'd like to thank Dr. Natalie Hinkle for helping me with all the stellar math for this episode. She is awesome. So let us know down in the comments, do you want to be the dark side of the Force or the light side of the Force? Also, if you're curious about antimatter, click here to watch the video we just did explaining how antimatter works. The universe should have created half and half. One atom of matter, one atom of antimatter. But look around you. Matter is pretty much everywhere. Where'd all the antimatter go? This is one of the great mysteries of physics. Thanks for watching DNews, everyone. Make sure you subscribe for all of our episodes, and we will see you next time.